salmon bycatch is really difficult because it unfolds very quickly and can happen in very intense sort of small areas of the oceans. People felt was that if the boats knew where the bycatch was occurring, they'd be able to stay away from it. We actually worked with the fleas for quite a while before the pollock fishery was rationalized. And in those instances, we had a lot of people that were concerned about bycatch. That's why we were there in the first place. And we could actually define areas that were high in bycatch. Before we had rolling hotspots, there are lots of time and area closures that the council and the agency would come up with. And what you attempt to do is you attempt to predict where you're going to see bycatch occur in the ocean. And you draw a box around it and you say, okay, come August, we know that it's really pretty likely that there's going to be high bycatch of chum salmon in this box. And so we're just going to close it. And, you know, as it turned out, sometimes there is and sometimes there isn't. I mean, the fish just don't respect the boxes. We had a number of occurrences where it looked like the boxes were perfect, but the rule was wrong. You should have stayed in the box and not gone out of the box. At that point in time, you weren't guaranteed that you were going to catch a certain amount of fish. You were just guaranteed that you were going to fish as long as everybody else could fish. So if you went off somewhere else and you were not able, and your catch rate dropped in half and other people didn't move, you were simply going to lose out on fish because the season was going to evaporate in front of you while you were trying to avoid this bycatch and other people weren't. There's just too much individual loss involved in that. And the idea that somebody could drive away from good fishing because there was bycatch, it was something we couldn't pull it off until the fisheries got rationalized. There's just many different things that we can do that the government can't do. You know, the idea behind rolling hotspots is that fish basically have tails and they go swimming. They swim and they're found in places you can't always predict. The industry really came to support the idea that we would define these in season, and it requires rapid examination of good data, and we have that because we have federal observers on all the boats, and we are able to actually see where the bycatch is as opposed to where it's supposed to be. We have methods of compliance testing that are probably just not available to the government, and I think the main reason is because the boats have basically waived due process. We don't have to sit there and worry about whether we're going to fight somebody in court over whether they were actually fishing in a box, a closed area, because we have agreements that basically stipulate that if we find them in there and they're fishing, they're guilty. They can't appeal it. They just have to pay the fine. It just seems to work really well. And with co-ops, again, we have the tools to actually do it. I mean, people can afford to stay out of those areas, even if the fishing's good in them, because they know they're going to catch their fish somewhere else, and they know that nobody else is in there either. The single most important aspect of all this has been changing, not developing any technology, but changing the what I term is the social structure of the fisheries. You have to give people the right organizational tools so that they can afford to do this part of their job.
Want to learn more about sustainable fisheries, the Sea Alliance, and Alaska's fishing communities? The story continues on a social media channel near you.